Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
Hi friends, today we are going to talk about M.S. Golwalkar, that is Guruji. He was the second Sarsang Chalak of Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. He was born on 19th February 1906 at a place called Ramtek in the state of Maharashtra. Ramtek is near Nagpur. We are talking about Guruji today or M.S. Golwalkar today because he presided or he headed the RSS from 1940 to 1973, during which the organization expanded rapidly. It attained an outreach which was pan-India. In fact, it also expanded abroad. Most of the RSS affiliated organizations which you see today, they were set up during M.S. Golwalkar's tenure when he was the RSS chief. His life was actually fully dedicated to the RSS, and the expansion of the RSS coincides with his tenure as the RSS chief. So today we are also going to talk about some of the lesser known aspects about M.S. Golwalkar, that is Guruji. So first let's look at some of the organizations which were set up during his tenure. The RSS says that these are the RSS inspired organizations. Some of them call it RSS affiliated organizations also. So organizations like Bharatiya Jan Sangh, which is the erstwhile avatar of Bharatiya Janata Party, which is ruling the central government today and more than a dozen states. Akhil Bharatiya Vidyarthi Parishad, Vishv Hindu Parishad, which spearheaded the Ram Janmabhoomi movement, Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram, the Vidya Bharati, Samar Shiksha Samiti. So a whole lot of organizations were set up during his tenure, and as I have mentioned earlier, that the RSS truly attained a pan-India reach, and it entered Swayamsevaks entered every sphere of society. First let's look at how M.S. Golwalkar came in touch with the RSS. Actually, no, he was a student in Banaras Hindu University. In 1926, he did his BSc from there. In 1928, he did his MSc from there. So by that time, a senior RSS functionary, Bhaiyaji Dani, he had started a shakha in Banaras Hindu University. Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, he had a very soft corner for the RSS. He had, in fact, after founding the Banaras Hindu University, when the RSS shakha started there, he gave a separate space to hold the RSS shakha there. So Guruji came in contact with Bhaiyaji Dani. But then he was called to Nagpur by Dr. Hedgewar in 1932. In between, Guruji also taught in Banaras Hindu University for 3 years. And in fact, before that he was known as M.S. Golwalkar, or he was known by his family name Madhu. This name Guruji was given to him by his students in Banaras Hindu University. 1930. He was teaching in Banaras Hindu University. In 1934, he was appointed as the Karyava, that is the secretary in charge of the Sangh's main shakha, which was held at Tulsibagh at that time. But he had a spiritual bent of mind, so in 1936, he left Nagpur for Ramakrishna Mission at Ashram, and he took a Diksha there, which means that he took a sannyas there. So Guruji received his initiation on January 13, 1937. But the interesting part is that Amitabh Maharaj, with whom he stayed at Ramakrishna Ashram for a month in Nagpur after becoming a sannyasi, so he called Guruji's maternal uncle and he asked him to take him to Dr. Hedgewar. And then both Dr. Hedgewar and Guruji had a series of meetings, and then Guruji finally decided to dedicate his life for the work of RSS. So in 1939, he was appointed as the Sar Karyava, that is the General Secretary of Sangh. It's effectively, basically, you can say the most powerful executive position or the most important executive position in Sangh. And the interesting thing is that Bhaiyaji Dani, who had earlier introduced Guruji to Sangh, he in fact worked with him as Sar Karyava when Guruji became the RSS chief in 1940. So by 1932, actually, Dr. Hedgewar's health had started deteriorating, and in 1940, when he passed away, the senior functionaries of the RSS decided that M.S. Golwalkar, that is Guruji, should be made the next Sarsang Chalak. So this is how it started. The most important thing which Guruji did after he became the RSS chief or the Sarsang Chalak was to set up a Pracharak system. Earlier, during Dr. Hedgewar's time, what used to happen that the Swayamsevaks used to go at different places for their higher studies, and there they used to set up shakas. But Guruji set up a proper formal Pracharak system, which is today the backbone of RSS. It has more than 4,000 Pracharaks. Pracharak is basically a full timer. They call themselves actually the postcards without address, which means they can be sent anywhere by the organization. And they remain unmarried, they dedicate their whole life to the nation. In 1941-42, an interesting thing happened. Guruji made an appeal for youngsters to come forward and join as Pracharaks. And I'll give you some interesting data. The impact of his clarion call was phenomenal. 48 Pracharaks came from just Lahore in 1942. Of these, 10 were postgraduates, 2 doctors, 14 had degrees of Shastris, and others were BA and above matric. Similarly, 52 Pracharaks came out of the Amritsar city alone, and out of these there were 4 doctors. Then, so the RSS influence was growing, and in fact, the CID, which was under the British regime, it kept on sending reports about the RSS regularly. The report of, I am quoting from the National Archives, the report which was filed on 30th December 1943 says that Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh is moving ahead rapidly towards building a significant, highly significant All India organization, and membership of the Sangh is swelling continuously. In central provinces, the membership has increased from 32,000 to 33,344 and henceforth, and there is data about other provinces also. Then in run up to the partition, the Guruji Baba Sahab Apte and Bala Sahab Devras, these are the 3 stalwarts at that time of RSS, so they started touring country extensively. Hundreds of young men and middle-aged people started joining Sangh. In fact, the English Tribune wrote that if Punjab is the sword of arm of Hindustan, then RSS is the sword arm of Punjab. Guruji went to Sialkot and Montgomery after touring Multan in 1946-47. They were trying to organize Hindus and ensure that they don't suffer at the hands of Muslim mobs. The province of Sindh alone around had 80 shakas at that time. There were 52 Pracharaks, and one of them was none else than Lal Krishna Advani, who later on became the BJP president and the deputy prime minister. On January 30, 1948, Mahatma Gandhi was assassinated, and on February 2, Guruji was arrested and RSS was banned on February 4. In fact, nearly 20,000 Swayamsevaks were immediately arrested. Then Guruji was released on August 6, but he was again arrested on November 12, 1948 from Barakamba Road, Delhi. Then Guruji gave a call to Swayamsevaks to start a Satyagraha, and 77,000 Swayamsevaks quoted arrest. Finally, the government couldn't find anything against RSS, so the ban was lifted on the midnight of July 11, 1949, and Guruji was released on July 13, 1949 from Bethul prison in Madhya Pradesh. The year 1952 saw the RSS inspiring its Swayamsevaks under the leadership of Guruji to set up a model of Swadeshi education, so the first Saraswati Bal Mandir school was set up in Gorakhpur. In 1952, the RSS also launched the cow protection movement. The volunteers collected signatures from 94,459 villages and towns, and the total count of signature was 1,79,89,332, and these signatures were handed over to the then president of the India. One of the key impacts of the cow protection campaign was that the RSS at an organizational level, it got galvanized. In 1952, but prior to that, the RSS also had started major relief and rehabilitation work. So, again under the leadership of Guruji, a Seva Vibhag was set up. In 1951, the Bharatiya Jan Sangh was launched, and RSS loaned out its Pracharaks, some of its Pracharaks, which included people like Dindyal Upadhyay, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and Nanaji Deshmukh. In 1955, the RSS volunteers under the leadership of the former Pracharak of Delhi state, Vasantrao Oak, participated in a major way in liberation of Goa. Then Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh, which later on became the largest voluntary organization, was set up in July 1955. In the year 1960, Guruji warned the then government that China is going to attack India. But anyway, after the 1962 debacle, the efforts made by the RSS were recognized by the Nehru government, and an RSS contingent was invited to participate in the Republic Day Parade in 1963. Around 3,000 RSS Swayamsevaks participated in this march. Similarly, 1965, when Pakistan attacked India, Guruji told the RSS Swayamsevaks to come out and work for the country. In fact, he was so much respected at that time that when the Pakistan attacked India, Lal Bahadur Shastri ji, the then Prime Minister of India, invited Guruji for an all-party consultative meeting in Delhi, even though the RSS was not a political outfit. So when the ceasefire happened, Guruji disagreed with it. In fact, he said, I quote, "In fact, our war of independence would not reach a successful conclusion until we liberate the whole of Pakistan. There is no meaning whatever in raising the bogey of what the world would say." Guruji was also of the opinion that Shastriji should not go to Tashkent to sign for negotiations. And as we all know that Shastriji died a mysterious death in Tashkent. Then in 1966, Vishwindu Parishad was set up. All the Dharmacharyas were brought on the same stage. The key reason was basically to introduce social reforms. In May 1970, by that time Guruji had started feeling unwell and his health had started deteriorating. In 1970, he was detected with cancer and he underwent a surgery. But even after the surgery, instead of taking rest, he again resumed his countrywide tour. In fact, it is said that Guruji had toured the whole country more than 65 times during his tenure as the RSS Sarsanghchalak. But Guruji was also, not only he was unwell, but many of his colleagues in RSS passed away between 1972-73. One of the biggest losses to him was Baba Saab Apte, who passed away at Nagpur on July 27, 1972. Apte was also close confidant of Dr. Hedgewar. In 1971, again there was an India-Pakistan war. On December 3, 1971, Pakistan had attacked India. In a statement issued on December 4, 1971, Guruji appealed to the countrymen, "The unity inspired by the genuine love for the motherland alone can lead us to victory." The RSS, as desired by the Guruji, lent its full support for the defense efforts. So Bangladesh was liberated after an emphatic victory of Indian Defense Forces in December 1971. It's an interesting thing that the letter which Guruji wrote to Indira Gandhi after this victory in Bangladesh war. I quote, Guruji wrote this letter to the then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi on December 22, saying, "May the unity of this country, a realistic assessment of the situation and the determination to preserve the honor and prestige of the country continue like this. This is necessary not only in times of danger but for all time and for all activities of national renaissance. In the creation of the strength of national unity infused with national pride, the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh is and will always be with you." In 1972, his health deteriorated further, and on April 2, 1973, he wrote three letters in his own hand and handed them over to his office secretary, Pandurang Kshirsagar. On June 5, 1973, Guruji passed away. The three letters which Guruji had given to Kshir Sagar were opened in the presence of all the senior functionaries of RSS. In one of the letters, he had entrusted the Sarsangh Chalak's responsibility to Bala Sahab Devras, who then became the third RSS Sarsangh Chalak. In another letter, he had directed that there should be no memorial to him made for him. In the third letter, he had quoted the final humble prayer of Saint Tukaram, "O saints and holy men, convey this my final prayer to God. O God, do not forget me. What more I can say? You, my Lord, know everything. I bow to you. Take me into the shelter of your grace."